Hi, everyone. I'm Frank Malicote. I'm an anchor reporter for KTVU's Fox 2 here in the San Francisco Bay Area. My guest is the managing editor for Apartment Guides. He's based in Atlanta. He's got some tips on how to make your living space at your apartment a little more secure during COVID-19 and your rights as a renter if you can't pay your rent. And that all-important question, how do you approach your landlord? What can you do? Let's say hi to Brian Carberry. Brian, good morning, good afternoon. How are you?
Hey, I'm well. How are you doing?
I'm well. Let's start with that daunting question. A lot of folks financially strapped right now. Some have been furloughed. Some are out of jobs completely. They don't have money in the bank, and the rent is due. How do you approach your landlord?
Yeah, the first thing you really need to do is just be open and honest with your landlord as early as you can that you know that you're going to be in trouble or potentially not going to be able to afford a rent payment. Let them know what you're going through, the situation that you're in, and come up with some proactive plans that you might have for ways that you still can pay some or a portion of your rent. Landlords and property managers are all kind of handling this in their own way. A lot of them may have a rent deferral plan or rent payment plan already in mind. But if you take steps and show them that you're already kind of thinking along those lines, it'll be a lot easier for you both to reach some sort of agreement and, you know, find a way to pay the rent that you do owe.
And even maybe like a payment plan, that kind of thing. I can give you X, I'll give you X next month and try to make it up in August.
Yeah, you know, we're seeing really all across the board, we're seeing a lot of different things, but one of the most common things is that rent payment plan. If you can only afford a portion of your rent right now, you know, the rest of it kind of gets tacked on later, or rent deferral plan. So say for the next 2 or 3 months, you don't have to pay your rent, but then it will be split among, you know, 12, 18, whatever it might be, equal payments for the remainder of your lease, depending on how long that lease is. Another option that's becoming popular for people that really only need a month or two worth of rent help is to dip into your security deposit. When you rent an apartment or when you rent a home, you're putting down anywhere from a month to 2 months worth of rent, you know, on average. So that is money that is going to come back to you, assuming there's no damages or anything like that to your unit. So you could ask your landlord, your property manager, whoever it might be, if you can use some of that money to pay for the rent that you do owe. In some cases, they'll make you pay back some of that security deposit and kind of like a payment plan like you would with rent, or you'll just have to be risking that when you move out, if there's any damage beyond normal wear and tear, you might have to pay some of it out of pocket. But really, if you have needs right now and you need money right now, that is an option for you that is becoming more popular, and it's worth asking the question if that's something that they'll allow you to do.
And I would imagine the tone of your voice too. You got to have a little empathy for the landlord because they're not all huge conglomerates with, you know, money falling out of their pockets. I own a rental property in New Hampshire, and if he couldn't pay, that would hurt me because it all kind of trickles up too, doesn't it?
Absolutely. Yeah. You know, we see the image in our minds of these landlords just kind of sitting in their offices, not having a financial care in the world. But in most cases, that's not true, because even if it's a large company, they have a lot of employees that they still need to pay. They've got maintenance staff, they've got leasing agents. They're doing things to keep the property clean with cleaning staff, and it all costs money. So really, if you can't afford to pay your rent, it kind of does trickle down to them as well. And especially if you're in a situation where, you know, like you said, you own a house and you're renting it out and it's just one person. If that person can't pay their rent, it could impact your landlord's ability to pay their mortgage. And it really does have a broader impact than you might realize. That's why it's really important just to have that communication with them. Let your landlord know what you can and can't do so they can make plans on their end too.
Yeah, makes sense. What if your landlord says, you know, Brian, I feel for you, but too bad, pay up. What do you do then?
You know, there are a lot of landlords that are willing to help people out, but unfortunately, there's also going to be a select few that probably aren't going to be as willing to cater to some of your requests that you might have. Really, the best thing that you can do in a situation like that, other than, you know, getting down on your knees and begging, which, you know, you guess you could do, really just let them know, again, kind of what you're dealing with. Try to make concessions to your original request. Maybe if you were asking for a rent deferral plan, see if you can pay a portion of that rent rather than just kind of pushing it all off. If it's still, there's nothing working, they're not budging, look into some of the local programs or, you know, statewide programs that you have available to you. A lot of states have rental assistance programs, loans, grants like that, that you might be able to take advantage of. Just do some research online in your local city or your local state and see what's available. And then let your landlord know that, hey, I'm taking this proactive step. So they do know that you are trying to do something, that you're working to kind of live up your end of the bargain, because you are going to have to pay rent, you know, regardless of if it's deferred and you don't have to do it now. But I mean, you are going to have to pay it back. You're not going to live rent free right now. So just show that you are taking those steps to try to do what you can. And they might change their mind.
What about the CARES Act, $2.2 trillion? Was there anything in there for people that couldn't pay their rent?
You know, in the original CARES Act, it was mostly with the stimulus checks that each individual renter may get if they fall into specific, you know, income and you know, number of dependent categories. Some people got some checks, some people didn't. From what I've seen, a next round of stimulus checks or next round of relief packages that may be coming from the government may include a lot more rental assistance. But as of right now, and I mean, you know, this is changing every day, depending on which side of the aisle you're asking, they'll tell you where the progress is and what's going to be included. But, you know, we are looking to see if something like that will be included in the next round. But just like anything in politics and in Washington, who knows what's going to get done, when it's going to get done, or what will even be included. Right. So it's kind of a fingers crossed thing at this point, but if I were a renter and I were kind of hoping for that money, I wouldn't hold my breath for it, because as I said, you don't know what it's going to be, when it's going to come, and if it's going to come.
Well, there's still a lot of people just waiting for that stimulus check. That needed as well. Is there anything in that CARES Act about being evicted? Did they lay down some new rules in terms of you can't do this the first month or the second month if they're trying, so to speak?
Yeah, you know, there's a lot of different rules for evictions right now. And the most common one is just kind of a freeze on evictions. And the latest I saw, and I could be wrong on this, but the latest I saw was through the end of July. That is kind of changing, and each city and state will have their own laws as well. I know, for instance, in California, I read that as long as you are trying to pay that money back, you have basically a year to do so before you can actually be evicted. That might be more, you know, a local law somewhere else that, you know, in portions of California it might follow, in other portions it isn't. So really just do your homework and find out what it is where you live, because there is a lot of confusion, because it is different everywhere. And some landlords and property managers might not even know the local laws in their area. So you may unfortunately run into a situation where they try to, you know, potentially start the eviction process when they're really not supposed to. I don't think they're doing that maliciously. I think they're just unaware of what the rules are right now. So if there are questions, I mean, go to your landlord, ask them, do your research. If all else fails, contact your local sheriff's department, because in most cases, they're the ones they're going to be carrying out the eviction. So they'll know what those laws are.
Yeah. And I would think if you're a landlord and you've got, you know, a tenant that's trying to pay or at least work something out with you, you're maybe better off keeping he or she in your rental apartment or home, as opposed to going out in the midst of a pandemic, marketing that place may stay empty for two or three more months, who knows, 6 months, to try to get somebody new in there who may run into the same problem.
Yeah, absolutely. Right now, I mean, people are still looking to move, like leases are still ending, people are still relocating, you know, jobs are still, you know, coming up across the country, and people are moving. But a lot of people that we saw that were looking at apartments before, just as kind of like, oh, I wonder what it'd be like to live in this building, and they don't have to move, have stopped looking. The people that are looking right now are actually motivated to move and need to move. That being said, as a landlord, it is a lot easier to keep a tenant in their current property, in their current unit, then having to find someone else, possibly missing out on a month, 2 months, 3 months, whatever it might be, worth of rent. And a lot of landlords right now are even offering, I guess, incentives to their tenants to extend their leases without an increase in rent that would normally be there. Again, this is going to be something that each individual property manager and landlord is going to handle in their own way. There's no set guidelines of what they're going to do, but they do want to keep their, you know, properties as full as possible with people that want to live there. So if you have a lease coming up, you might have a little bit more wiggle room in your negotiation than you normally would. You know, ask them about some of those, you know, rental incentives, a free month potentially, which really just get, you know, prorated throughout the year, but it could be a slight rent reduction for you, or a, you know, a better parking spot, any type thing that really is negotiated in your lease, you might have a little bit more power right now than you normally would.
Well, I think communication is the key. I know Apartment Guides did a survey last month talking to would-be renters that are having a tough time. What did you guys conclude from that? What are they saying?
Yeah, you know, the main takeaway that we found, and it really isn't too surprising if you really think about it, is that 4 out of 10 renters said that they were worried about their ability to pay rent as early as May. We haven't gone back to look to see how many of those people actually were able to pay rent or how many weren't able to, but it really just shows that, I mean, the struggle is real for a lot of people that have been furloughed or have lost their jobs or had wages cut or hours cut. They are struggling to find a way to live right now because a lot of people don't necessarily have money put aside in savings for an emergency. There are a lot of people that are living paycheck to paycheck, and unfortunately, that's a lot of renters. So when their steady stream of income gets disrupted, you know, they are going to worry about their ability to pay rent. Now, fortunately, other data that I've recently seen from the National Multifamily Housing Council has said that through the first 6 days of May, about 80% of renters were able to pay their rent, which really doesn't seem like a lot, you know, at first glance. But when you dig deeper, if you compare that to the same time period over April, that's actually higher. So in April, it was really only about 78%. And then as the month went on, you know, it kind of went up. And in April, it was, you know, more than 90% of people were paying rent. So we'll see what happens as this month goes on. You know, a lot of landlords have waived late fees to give renters more time to make their rent payments. So I do suspect that as the month goes on, more people are going to pay their rent. But I also wouldn't be surprised if that number is down from April and continues to slide down through the summer months, depending on, you know, how long all of this lasts.
Yeah, and who knows? Here in San Francisco, you know, it's obviously very expensive around the Bay Area. And a lot of the younger folks, maybe in their 20s and 30s, might have a couple of roommates in an apartment or a house here in the city. Shelter in place to go back home to Portland and Reno, and you're stuck holding. What advice would you give to that one roommate that's stuck going, now what do I do? Two of my roommates just took off.
Yeah, you know, it's a situation that is kind of common that we're seeing. You know, a lot of people are making arrangements, though, with their roommates. They're saying, you know, I am going to go home and, you know, live with mom and dad in their, you know, countryside, you know, house, right, rather than being cooped up in the middle of the city. The best thing that you really can do in a situation like that, if your roommate's name is on the lease, they are still required to make that rent payment, regardless of it's deferred or when it is. Like, they still do owe a portion of that rent. So really have that conversation with a roommate if they are going to, you know, move out temporarily. If they're going to try to move out for good and break their end of the lease, I mean, technically you could take legal action. Whether you'd want to right now, that's a different story. A better solution might be to try to find a subletter for that unit. Someone that is looking for a place to live, maybe might not want to sign a full year's lease, but just kind of needs to get into someplace new. That is an option for them. But really just kind of have a good line of communication with your roommates so no one really gets the short end of the stick and everyone still is paying what they owe.
Well, let's talk about shelter in place, because a lot of us are at home, but if you live in an apartment building, it gets tougher because there's common areas. You got to go to the elevator, you got the lobby, the mail room, if you're doing your laundry, that kind of thing. What advice do you have for people that live in complexes? And also, what advice do you have if your landlord or management company really isn't doing much to keep you folks apart?
Sure. So first thing first, your landlords and property managers should have closed common spaces that aren't essential. So anything like a gym is probably going to be closed. A clubhouse might be closed or just limiting the number of people that can go in there at a time. The pool may or may not be closed, but there's going to be other areas that are still going to be open that are deemed more essential. So your mail rooms, your laundry facilities, places like that. An elevator is an area that is really enclosed space that a lot of people might need to use, especially in high-rise apartments. Really, the best thing that you can do if you have to leave your unit, and I would say only leave your unit if you really have to, you know, if you're going to get the mail, for instance, go early in the morning or late at night so you don't run into someone. I mean, you still might, but the chance of you bumping into a neighbor at 8 a.m. is probably a lot less than the chance of bumping into a neighbor at noon on any given day, especially because a lot of people are home right now. Sure. You know, if you, wherever you go in these units or these properties, try to avoid touching any of these public common areas. So light switches, doorknobs, railings with your bare hands. I mean, bring a handkerchief, bring a towel, bring a napkin, anything that you can do to kind of limit that exposure that you have. Try to take the stairs if you can, but don't grab onto the handrails. You know, if someone is coming towards you, wait on a landing or kind of move over to the side so you can maintain as much of a distance as you can. If you need to ride the elevator, wait your turn if someone else is already on it so you can try to ride as much of it as you can by yourself. If someone gets on when you're already on it, consider just getting off of that floor and waiting for the elevator to come back.
Right.
If you really are in a rush and you need to ride the elevator with someone else, just kind of turn slightly the other way so you're not facing them. Try not to touch the wall of the elevator or really lean against anything. Use an elbow to press buttons. A lot of this is hard because it's, you know, subconsciously you just go and press an elevator button with your finger. But, you know, it's things that you just need to kind of train your mind and train your habits to do. And wherever you go and whatever you do, if you've talked to someone, if you run into someone or not, just make sure you wash your hands as soon as you get back into your unit just to, you know, be safe.
Yeah, we were talking about habits hard to break. In late March, when things were getting a little dicey, you know, we have guests come in on our morning show, and I would stand up and shake their hands all the time. And my other half at home would say, "What, are you crazy?" And I, you know, subconsciously, you just forget. And it's going to take a while to kind of lose some old habits, especially greeting and being in crowds, I would imagine, right?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, I think at this point, a lot of people have kind of realized what they need to do. You know, a month ago, everyone was still getting used to it. But at this point, you know, everyone's kind of figured out their new routines, their new normal. And unfortunately, the people at this point that aren't social distancing, and there's probably going to be a group in your apartment community that are still going to get together, sit closer than 6 feet down by a grill that, you know, may or may not be open, or just kind of casually gather. At this point, they're probably not going to follow these guidelines if they haven't already, or they were following them and have just kind of gotten anxious and want to get out right now. And I think that's going to be the big struggle for a lot of people as certain states and certain areas start to reopen. People are going to kind of rush into it rather than taking the baby steps. You know, if you run before you learn how to walk, you're going to fall. Right. And in a situation like this, I think everyone just needs to be patient, follow the guidelines that are coming down from, you know, health officials, your local government, and really just still do your best to maintain that social distance, because it'll be a lot easier to get back to, you know, quote unquote normal a month from now if we take baby steps than it would be if we all run out to the store and all run out and hang out and high five and whatnot. And then 2 weeks from now, there's a huge surge of cases and, you know, we're back to where we were. So that's just one thing that, you know, in an apartment community, you may see some of your neighbors doing that, and, you know, to each their own, but do your best to still maintain that distance.
Well, let's talk about Georgia. You are in Georgia in the city of Atlanta. I know your governor's been kind of on the forefront to opening up a little early. How are things in your state right now? And are restaurants open? What's the status?
Yeah, you know, it really depends who you ask how things are going. You know, Governor Kemp has still said that cases are holding steady or are declining. You know, hospital vacancies are slightly going down. I'm taking his word for it because I don't have access to any of the data. You know, you really can look at multiple data sources and make data say what you want. So, you know, I'll take it with a grain of salt. I will say in Atlanta, a lot of the businesses here have really not followed his guidelines to open, in which case they are staying closed. Or if they are opening, they're still just doing takeout only. They're doing their best to maintain social distancing. A lot of people are ordering takeout and trying to support these local businesses from what I've seen. So there are a lot of businesses that are still doing a lot of really good business right now and getting a lot of customers. A couple of my neighbors who are chefs at restaurants that have closed have started doing kind of like meal delivery type things. You know, they're getting their ingredients, cooking it, and, you know, you can order through an email list or through Facebook or whatever it might be. So people are finding a way to get by with it. I haven't gone bowling or gotten a tattoo since those are open, so I really can't what's going on there. But yeah, but restaurants, you know, at least in Atlanta, everyone's still very cautious about it. I know yesterday the governor released a couple loosened guidelines, so restaurants now can serve parties of 10 instead of 6 and certain things like that, but bars and live music entertainment facilities still need to stay closed through the end of May. So, you know, we are making progress opening up. I'm still on the fence about whether it's going to be successful, whether we're going to see a surge in cases or not. I'm kind of taking a wait and see approach, as a lot of people are. But there are definitely some people that have said, hey, things are opening up, I'm going to go out and live my life. So, and I think that's going to be anywhere.
You go on Facebook or Twitter or whatever, some are, you know, just like politics, way over here and way over here. And some of us are like, well, I'll put my toe in the water, but I'm not going to race to the beach the minute the doors open.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, I'd love to go to the beach right now, but I'm not going to. So.
Absolutely. Well, Brian, if people want to get in touch with you and get more information about Apartment Guides, how do they do that?
So the best way to get information on the, you know, the content that we're putting out is just go to our blog. So it's apartmentguide.com/blog. There's information there about basically any range of topics that a renter might face right now, from living during coronavirus to finding an apartment to dealing with a landlord if something's going on, to lease questions, DIY things if you're bored, really anything that you could need there. And if you need to contact me, just, you know, look me up on LinkedIn and add me, send me a message, and I'll respond.
Very good. All right. Well, he's Brian Carberry. He's the managing editor of the Apartment Guides. Brian, I want to thank you for joining us this morning, this afternoon, out of Atlanta.
Thank you so much. Have a good one.
All right. That's Brian. I'm Frank Malicote here with Fox in the San Francisco Bay Area. If you'd like more information, always go to coronavirusnow.com.